Hi everyone, Professor King here. In this video, I'm going to be talking about bell hooks' postmodern blackness, and then we'll relate it at the end to Edgar Allan Poe's short story, Hop Frog. As usual, I'll dive right in, and always, if you have questions, comments, or concerns, please make sure to message me as soon as possible. So, share screen, where are you? There you are. Here we go. My dog Lionel again, if you can hear him in the background, he's arguing with himself. All right, so let's go to Postmodern Blackness by bell hooks. Bell hooks is a pseudonym, but that is essentially what she goes by. It is all in lowercase. That's not a typo on my part. So if you want to write about bell hooks in your essays, make sure to keep those lowercase. That's her thing. All right. So I'll move my screen here so you can see. First off, what is postmodernism? It's a rejection of early 20th century modernism. Modernism was influenced heavily by the Great War, World War I, and to a lesser extent, World War II and late modernism. It was very bleak, very much dealt in realism and sort of realistic situations. And postmodernism wanted to kind of blow all that up. You may hear another term, which is post-structuralism. Not post-structuralism, deconstructionism. And here's kind of the difference. Snobs who think they're smart will call it deconstructionism. Artists who don't care will call it postmodernism. But these deconstructionists claim that postmodernism isn't real, it's not a real school. It's a silly theoretical argument on either side. So for the sake of this, we will talk in terms of postmodernism as a reaction to modernism and as its own school of theory. What does it have to do with? Oh, and again, these some of these concepts are from a book, Beginning Theory, by Peter Barry. This is the book, if you're ever curious. You may have to, if you go into a four-year and you take a literary theory class, they may make you read this. Hopefully not. It's kind of boring, to be honest with you, but it's helpful. So anyway, Barry talks about how postmodernism is parody and pastiche. And what we mean by parody is it's not the realistic interpretation of the thing. It's the sort of hyperbolic, exaggerated, ridiculous, surreal extrapolation of the thing, right? So we'll look at that in a moment. And then pastiche. Pastiche is like collage. It's the literary essential equivalent to collage. So we take sort of, elements of all these things and we create something new from what is old, right? And I'll show you an example of pastiche in just a moment as it pertains particularly to Black modernism. It's a rejection of the divine pretensions of authorship. So you'll see guys like Jacques Derrida and Jacques Lacan talking about like how the author doesn't matter and, just sort of one of the things about postmodernism is play, this notion of play, playing with stability, playing with what's real, playing with structure, right? So we're getting rid of all the old pretensions and we're playing with these ideas, right? And so in that play, we have a celebration of fragmentation. And that's kind of where pastiche also comes in, right? Because we're taking fragments of all these different things and we're creating a whole new narrative, a whole new cohesive thing with them, like a collage does, or a mosaic or something like that. My brain stopped there, sorry guys. Another very significant characteristic of postmodernism is that there's no difference between high and low art, right? Or high and popular art. So whereas previous schools of theory would only look at, opera and literature with a capital L and things like that. Postmodernists will look at things like, a can of soup or a music video or anything, right? There's no, you know, the sort of pretensions of high art and art has to be, you know, this, that, and the other, again, are sort of blown out for in favor of looking at the whole world as a playing field. So again, these are from Beginning Theory by Peter Berry. This is just sort of the general definition of postmodernism. So when we get to Hooks, right? Hooks is now taking this concept of postmodernism and building on it, right? Again, just like in the video on Freud, I talked about, you know, Freud was problematic in certain ways. So people who came later, like feminist theorists, built upon and kind of judged or adjusted some things to make it less problematic. Hooks is kind of doing the same thing here with a whole school of theory. And what Hooks says is, yes, in modernism, there is this emphasis on difference, or what Jacques Derrida is a big deconstructionist, postmodernist theorist. There's this emphasis on difference or différence, right? Derrida was a French guy. And otherness, okay? However, as Hooks points out, right, it's pioneers, it's adopters, very privileged, white male centric. Jacques Derrida, white guy. Jacques Lacan, white guy, right? And Andy Warhol, white guy, right? So, and so many others, white folk, right? So Hooks is like, okay, on the one hand, you're saying you're celebrating difference and otherness. On the other hand, y'all look the same as all the theorists who came before you for the most part. So there's some problems, right? The first problem is that this snobbery, this inherently racist snobbery, with the idea that there's no meaningful connection between Black experience and critical thinking. And Hooks is here to say, that is not the case, right? Like, she and people like Toni Morrison will argue that, you know, Blackness is, you know, like, is even more rife with critical thought and critical thinking than whiteness by the very fact that it's, you know, it's an identity that has to live in a national space of, you know, as the other constantly. And so if you're not in the center, right, if you're not the sort of norm, the white norm, and you always have to look at things from the outsider's perspective or from the marginalized perspective, then of course you're going to have a more critical lens, because you're not like up close, not seeing all the other stuff. You're not blinded by your privilege, in other words. You have that distance of otherness to make you more critical. And Hooks has a problem with the hypocrisy of postmodernist discourse, right? It directs its critical voice to a specialized audience that shares a common language rooted in the very master narrative it claims to challenge. So again, like if we're celebrating these things like otherness and popular art and, you know, we're arguing against classism and elitism, but at the same time, we're speaking in a language and we have representatives that are very white and elitist and traditional speaking and looking, right? There's a hypocrisy in that, and Hooks is getting at that, right? So I told you that I would show you an example of Black postmodernism. This is not an example of what Hooks calls postmodern Blackness. However, it is an example of postmodernism by a Black artist. So just make that distinction right now. But this is going to help illuminate some of the things that Hooks talks about. And it's also going to illustrate how what she argues, how postmodernism really, you know, like cannot exist without Blackness, right? Like how we have to look at postmodernism with the not just the inclusion of Blackness, but from the Black perspective. And so I don't know if you know this song, but I know the 90s are back in a big way. Ice Cube's Bop Gun. I just want to play the song for you, and I want you to pay particular attention to the lyrics. You know, if you got to close your eyes and like not even think about the video, that might help. But think about the lyrics. And if you even want to pull them up on your phone, I'll try and get closed captioning on here, but if it doesn't work, pull the lyrics up on your phone and follow along as you listen and see if you notice anything about the lyrics of this song.
Hello? Yo, Q. What's up, Mr. George? Come on through, man. We're having a little get-together.
I don't know, man. Your get-togethers are kind of wild.
Come on, man. You know it's One Nation under a group.
I know we One Nation.
Come on through, man.
All right. I'll be there.
So wide you can't get around it. So low you can't get under it. So high you can't get
Here we go.
All right, I'll stop there. But I want you to think about some of these lyrics and think about, I don't know if you noticed the kind of older guys that are in the video, if any of you follow older music, they may be familiar to you. But if you hear the lyrics like jamming on the good foot, so rough, so tough, the disco fiend with the monster sound, I wants to get funked up, the Buffalo girls go around the outside, double Dutch bus, ring my bell, pass the Dutchie, flashlight, what you gonna do when you get out of jail? If any of these lyrics sound familiar to you, it's because every single line in this song is adapted from an old funk song. And it's a variety of different artists. So the Goodfoot line would be James Brown. So Rough, So Tough would be Zapp and Roger Troutman. The Disco Fiend and the Funked Up lines, those are Parliament Funkadelic, who, if you notice the people in the video, the guy with the kind of neon dreadlocks is George Clinton, and the guy with the big sunglasses is Bootsy Collins, who are members of Parliament Funkadelic. Double Dutch Bus, Ring My Bell is Anita Ward, Pass the Dutchie, Flashlight's another Parliament Funkadelic song, and What You Gonna Do When You Get Out of Jail is from Genius of Love by the Tom Tom Club. And there are more than that, that these are just kind of the ones I quickly jotted down as I was listening. But every single line in this song is taken from an old funk song from the 60s, 70s, and 80s. And so if we think about that in terms of pastiche, right? What Ice Cube is doing in this song is he's taking, again, these fragments from fragmentation, right? From the last slide we looked at, he's taking these fragments and he's creating a new narrative out of these fragments. And you may want to pause right here and think about, what is the narrative? What is the message? What is the overall impression of this song? In other words, if this is a text, what is Ice Cube arguing in this text? So take a minute, think about that. All right, so when you come back after you click play. When you come back after thinking about that, you know, maybe your interpretation of the song had something to do with like having fun or partying, or maybe you noticed that phrase, one nation under a groove, right? Like this idea of people coming together and of enjoying life, of there being happiness and fun and joy and partying. You know, people are dancing in the video. They've got, you know, they've got cars on hydraulics. They may be enjoying some, at the time, illicit substances. You know, there is a joy in this song. And so why would Ice Cube, in 1993, as he says at the beginning of the song, or he does it like this, I always like that. Why in he be saying, hey, you know, think about setting, think about historical context, think about biographical context. I, as someone from Inglewood, California, right? Not me, I'm talking as if I were Ice Cube. I, as a Black man from Inglewood, California, who is a former member of NWA, right? Who is living in Southern California in 1993, why would I be sharing a message of, hey, we're one nation, let's come together, let's be happy, let's enjoy things? Any ideas? Maybe pause and think about it. Well, one interpretation could be that in 1992, most of you were not born then, but some of you may have been alive. In 1992 was when the LA uprising happened after Rodney King was brutally beaten by cops and they were found not guilty and there was an uprising in Southern California. And so Ice Cube makes this song immediately on the heels of that, right? That celebrates Blackness, that celebrates these songs from Black culture, that has this message of unity and of joy, right? So that's where the new narrative comes in, right? And he takes these old, you know, fragments of these old works of art, right? Popular art, funk songs from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and he creates this new message with them, right? So that would be an example and I would say a wonderful example of postmodernism. So thinking about that in terms of hooks, right? And in terms of, again, the Black presence in postmodernism and the need to acknowledge the Black presence in postmodernism. We'll move on. We have to talk about identity, right? And again, identity in terms of Blackness. And the postmodernist view is, as we've mentioned, problematic, right? And one of the reasons that Hooks talks about it being problematic is this notion of essentialism. And essentially, what essentialism says is that the givens of existence are fixed, are unchanging, are inherent. In other words, people and the way that we perhaps describe people or groups of people, that the way that we perhaps stereotype groups of people, that we attribute those characteristics as if they are inherent, as if they are indicative of who those people are at their core, unchanging. And Hooks says, no way, right? That is not, you know, if we think about the Black experience in America, it is definitely a result of external factors, right? Such as, you know, the enslavement of people since 1619. Various ways that Black people have been disenfranchised, right? Have been brutalized, have been, you know, unofficially enacted, have been unofficially bearing the brunt of a genocide put against them for the last 400 years. So all of those things are not inherent to Blackness, right? They're things that come from the outside that affect Blackness. And so postmodernism is anti-essentialist in theory, right? And so identity is something in postmodernism that is shifting, that is changing, that is fluid, right? That can be given up, right? Like the death of the author. But it's, Hooks says, it's easy to give up identity when you've got one. But if you are a marginalized voice, and this doesn't just apply to Blackness, right? This applies to any marginalized voice. If you're a marginalized voice and you've never been at the forefront, you've never been the norm, you've always been pushed to the margins and your identity has been effaced or ignored, then that becomes problematic in terms of postmodernism, because you never got the chance to even give your identity up, right? And, you know, it's this white supremacist society that encourages this monolithic or this essentialist view of Blackness as unchanging, as inherent, right, as all these things. So what should postmodernist Black folks do, right? They should adopt or appropriate essentialism that incorporates multiple Black identities. They should critique essentialism while emphasizing authority of experience, right? The identity is important. This is where she's fixing some of these postmodernist concepts, right? As they apply to race. She says, and she's speaking to Black postmodernists as her audience. So she says, reassess our relationship to popular culture and resistance struggle, but she's including everyone else in that too. And Black intellectual participation in the discourse should be included in conjunction with a continued commitment to and participation in the interests of the Black community. So yeah, sure, decenter whiteness, but recenter Black people and other marginalized groups, right? Or center in the, I shouldn't say recenter, center in the first place, right? And if we think about what's going on in our world today, right? That's what a lot of these, I mean, that's what Black Lives Matter is saying, right? It's not saying that other lives don't matter. It's not saying that, it's not saying anything else other than we have never been at the center of the table. We've never been at the head of the table, right? And I don't mean me, clearly. I'm not a Black person, but Black Lives Matter is saying like that participation in the discourse, commitment to and participation in the Black community, right? Like that's important. So after all that, you know, what the heck does Ice Cube have to do with Hot Frog? How do we go from Edgar Allan Poe to Ice Cube? You know, there's a connection. There's a bridge. I'll lead you across. Well, yes, it's a story by a white guy written during pre-13th Amendment American slavery. And some can even argue that the 13th Amendment did not help the cause of Black people that much. But that's a conversation for another day, right? If you've ever seen the documentary 13th, you'll understand why. So yeah, those are our premises. Those are our givens. So how do we read postmodern Blackness into characters and situations from the story? Is there a character or are there characters who represent the marginalized, the other, whose very identities, particularly their ethnic identities, are erased or invisible or unknown? Are there characters who marginalize those voices and who oppress the ones whose voices, the ones who possess those voices? Do you think Hooks would, based on what you read in Hooks, do you think she would affirm or agree with our reading? Why or why not? But first we have to talk about what happens in the story, right? When does it take, think about the setting. Why would Poe set this in this sort of fantasy kingdom, right? Why would he characterize the king and Hop Frog and Trippetta and the seven council members? Why would he describe them the way that he does, right? Why the incident that ultimately happens? Why the ending, right? Within the context of when this is written, right? Within the context of all the other things that we're thinking about, within the context, I mean, read the language carefully of the text itself and come up with an idea. All right, so that's gonna do it for Hooks. I hope you enjoyed her. I always enjoy what she has to say, but you know, again, I'm a weirdo, so if you're a weirdo like me, awesome. I'm gonna take it off stop share now. Again, if any questions ever arise, if you're struggling, or if you just wanna, you know, talk to me about these ideas, I'm here. Zoom me, Canvas message me, email me, write comments back on Canvas. Hit me up on Instagram, ProfKingFCEnglish, whatever. I hope you all have a great day, and I will see you in cyberspace. Bye.